ओमज्ञानतिमिरन्धस्य ज्ञानाञ्जनशलाकाय चक्षुरोन्मीलितं येन तस्मै श्रीगुरवे नमः. नमः ॐ विष्णुपादाय कृष्णपृष्ठाय भूतले श्रीमते भक्तिवेदान्त स्वामी इति नामिने. नमस्ते सरस्वती देवे गौरवाणी प्रचारिणे निर्विशेष शून्यवादी पाश्चात्य देशतारिणे वाञ्छाकल्पतरुभ्यश्च कृपा सिन्धुभ्यैव च पतितानां पावनेभ्यो वैष्णवेभ्यो नमो नमः. जय श्री कृष्ण चैतन्य प्रभु नित्यानन्द श्री अद्वैत गदाधार श्रीवासादि गौर भक्तवृन्द. हरे कृष्णा 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 हरे हरे, हरे रामा राम रामा हरे हरे. Hare Krishna. I'm grateful to be here amongst all of you today. And I'll speak today on the topic of the challenges in practicing spiritual life in the material world. The theme here is that when Toshta chanted a mantra to have a powerful being appear who would kill the killer of his son, that is Indra. But instead he chanted it wrong, and the result of that was that instead of the child, the person who emerged, that person being the killer of Indra, that person became the one who was killed by Indra. So we often talk about this as a challenge of how difficult, say, the chanting of Vedic mantras was, how precise it needs to be, and in comparison with that, the chanting of Hare Krishna Maha Mantra is relatively easy. So, Dhiro Vadati Krishnaya Murkho Vadati Krishnave Ubhayostu Pursamam Punyam Bhavagrahi Janardana. So, it is said that normally the Vishnu, the adjective Vishna, Vishnave. But with Krishna, somebody may just take it that way, Krishnaya. So, it says Krishnaya, it makes it Krishnave. The grammatically it may be wrong, but bhavagrahi janardana, the Lord just looks at the emotion, the intention, and he's satisfied with that. So we could get some rough understanding of why the chanting of the mantras is so precise. Say some of us may have been from software backgrounds, or most of us know about programming. And while programming, you know, if we make one mistake in the code, sometimes the program may just do the opposite of what we want. So if there is some thread of logic where you have to put not, if you miss the not over there, then instead of doing what it should do, it will end up doing exactly the opposite of that. So similarly, the mantras, they're just as the programming code, there's a whole technology because of which that programming code is associated with the way certain things will result at physical level. So a device, instead of, say, if the program is, something is programmed wrong, say nowadays there are these, Google is trying to have automatic running cars. Now those cars, if some programming goes wrong and it sees, say, it senses an obstacle, and it senses an obstacle, it should veer to the right. But instead, if it veers towards the left, a small change in the code, it will just crash into that obstacle. So like that, at a material level, just as there is sophisticated technology, which if small mistake in it will lead to a big consequence. Similarly, the mantras are sound vibrations that are associated with higher powers in the universe. And when when the mantras are chanted wrong, then those higher powers are actually invoked wrongly. And then the result is that the effect may not come, or the effect may come exactly the opposite. Now, in our tradition, Jiva Goswami analyzes about mantras. Where is the power of mantras in general? And where is the power specifically in mantras centered on the chanting of the holy names? So broadly, if we consider Mimamsa, which is one of the systems of philosophy, they say there are two schools of thought. In Sanskrit, they are called as Varnavad and Sputavad. Varnavad means that the power, if there is a sound vibration, this is also a question in contemporary philosophy of language. Now, where is the meaning of words situated? Is the meaning of the words situated in the letters of the word, or is it situated in the minds of the speaker and the hearer? So that means we may say that the meanings, okay, for a meaning I just go and look in the dictionary and I find the meaning of the word. Yes, that's true, but sometimes words can have different meanings. When I was in England, I gave a class, and after that I had some very lively question answer session. The devotee who had organized the program, he was very happy, and he, with a bright smile, he came to me and says, "You killed it." I said, "My God, Allah, what did I kill?" So that, now, killed it is a rhetorical way of saying that it's from a hunting metaphor it comes. You answered the questions right, you did very well. So now, if I just go literally from the dictionary, there can be many different meanings. So the meaning of words, is it situated only in their letters, or is it situated in the minds of people? So normally, when we hear a word, if sometimes the word has different meanings, based on context, we understand what meaning will apply where. So the point is the meaning of word stored only in the content, or is it also stored in the context? So Varnavad says that Varna is letters, that the meaning is stored simply in the letters. And if those letters are recited perfectly, that's all that matters. Sphotaval, on the other hand, says that sphota means explosion. So what it means is that sometimes if somebody tells a joke, and at one moment we are just hearing, and next moment we start laughing. What has happened over there? At one particular moment, the meaning dawns within us. And when the meaning dawns, that's like an explosion inside. Oh, I understood. So if suppose somebody doesn't understand the joke, then everybody is laughing. Hey, what happened? Why are you laughing? So all of us heard the same set of words, but unless the meaning was understood rightly, the joke will not have the right impact. And sometimes jokes also involve play of words, like I earlier said. So why did Humpty Dumpty have a great fall? Because they had a great spring. So here, what has happened? Because they had a great spring. So there's fall can mean falling down. Fall can refer to falling down. Fall can also refer to a season. So here the meaning is stored not just in the content. You also have to look at the context. What is going on over here? Normally we associate one context, but there might be some other context going on over there. So basically, Varnavad holds mantras to be like formulas. When we are using a formula, we don't need to know the meaning of the formula. If I know for solving this sum, I have to use E equal to MC square. So okay, this is C, this is M, and this will be the E. So even if I don't understand the whole theory of relativity, if I just apply the formula, I get the result. So formulas, they may also have some meaning, but for using formulas, we don't necessarily need to know the meaning. That's why sometimes it's formulaic. Just do it like that, it will work. If some device, I may not understand how it works, like when we use technology, when we use cell phones, how many of us know the electromagnetic waves and the transmission technology? It's okay, press this button, and the call will go over there. It's a formula that we follow, and the result comes. So this is, so on contrast, Potavar holds that mantras are not formulaic, they are semantic units, that there is meaning involved over there. And to the extent we understand the meaning, to that extent the effect is there. So if, say, we come for a class, and like earlier I said, if a joke, we don't understand it, the sound vibrations are vibrated, but there is no impact over there. So now this analysis, that is it, when we come to when we look at ordinary conversations, there are both of these. There are semantic units which require comprehension, and there are formulaic units which just require application or usage. Results come. Now mantras, which category do they fall in? Are they formulas? Say, in our normal conversation, even if we make some mistake, say like for people whom English is not the first language, it's a second language, a third language, they may speak English in a broken way, but if there is an observer, okay, I think you mean this. So in that case, what happens with the context, even if the formula is not right, the communication takes place because the other person figures out what is being said. So are mantras like that? Are mantras like a formula, or are mantras units of meaning? So now in the traditional context, mantras, especially there are these six systems of philosophy, and in Karma Mimamsa, it is considered that even the gods are servants of the laws of nature. So that's why when Krishna told the Vrajavasis that if we do our duty, then Indra is obliged to give rains. So the gods don't have sovereignty. If the mantra is chanted right, then if the duty is done, the gods are obliged to give results. Like say, if we hire a cab. Now, if we are ready to pay for the cab, I want to go here. The cab person says, no, I don't want to go there. I won't go there. No, in some cities, you have to go. If you are going to be paid, wherever your customer is told, customer wants you to go, you have to go. If somebody says, you know, I will take only a person of this race and not of that race. I'll take only a person of this caste, not that caste. That kind of discrimination is not there. If you are paid, you have to provide it. But similarly, in Varanavad, the idea is mantras are just a combination of letters. If those letters are vibrated, the necessary result has to come. The intent is not seen, the context is not seen. So that is one way of looking at mantras. And in the Vedic understanding, the mantras which are used for invoking the gods or for getting some material results, often they are seen as Varanamad. They are manifestations of Varanavad. So that's why in the Vedas, the precise recitation is considered extremely important. When Rig Veda people would recite, they would recite it again and again and again to get the pronunciations right. In contrast to these are the Puranas. In the Puranas, the recitation is not as important as the import. And in fact, in the first canto, Prabhupada says in a purport, that Suta Goswami was not perfect in recitation of the Vedic mantras, but he knew their import and he spoke their import. So with respect to Vedas, means sometimes we use the word Veda in a very inclusive sense to refer to the whole Vedic body of knowledge. But here I am using Veda in the specific sense to refer to the four Vedas, Rig Veda, Sam Veda, Yajur Veda, Athur Veda. There, the principle is that the mantras have to be chanted precisely. So mantras are like technology. If somebody is an internet service provider, then once I use the internet, I can use the internet to find out how to murder someone. I can Google that and Google will give results for that. So it's like that, somebody chants a particular mantra, even if they're chanting it for destructive purposes, the results will come over there. And if they chant something wrong, the wrong results will come. So in this case, he chanted the mantra wrong and the opposite result came. In the Puranas, the recitation, the import is more important. In the Puranas, it is the meaning that matters. And that's why in the Puranas, there are sometimes Prabhupada is quite nonchalant about textual issues. Say sometimes, some people say this verse is like this. And some people say this verse is like this. One letter or something is different in someone. But that's perfectly okay. The first verse of the of Prahlad's prayers. Brahma Deya Surgana Munayo Tasiddha Sattvaikatam Vachasayo Sattvaikatam Gatayo Vachasam Pravahi Naraditam Puruganair Adhunapi Pipru Kim Toshtu Marathi Hare Ugrajate. So Prahlad is praying over there that, my dear Lord, Brahma Deya Surgana, that all these great Brahmaji and great Devatas and the great sages, they have offered you prayers and they have not been able to satisfy you. How can I satisfy you when I am lowborn? Sattvaikatam gatayo vachasam pravahai. Now, in some renditions of the Bhagavatam, instead of gatayo, there is matayo. Gatayo is the flow, Matayo is the opinion. So with their opinions, with their glorification, they are trying to satisfy you. But they're not satisfied. But they are not satisfied, they are not able to satisfy you. How will I be able to satisfy? So this is a minor textual issue. And traditionally, whenever commentaries would be written, at that time, they would actually describe that right in the beginning, there would be a preface, more like you could say, it's primarily for scholars, that okay, this verse, in this manuscript, I found it to be like this. This verse, I found it to be like this. This verse, I found it to be like this. And then they accommodate some differences. When transcription, when there will pathantar. Pathantar means, there is in the, now we can just print books, we can Xerox books. But in the past, people would have to write the books. And in the writing, sometimes some mistake might happen. So, pathantar bhed it is called. From one replica to another replica, when I make, some bheda may happen. Some change may happen. So, at that time, the commentators would look at, whenever somebody is going to comment on a particular book, they would look at these different commentaries, or different books, different manuscripts. And they would say, okay, this is said here like this, this is said here like this. And eventually, they would deem that this is the more authoritative version, or they would explain with both versions. Now, there would be no major discrepancies because they would take care of that. But the point I'm making is that as long as the meaning is conveyed, the literal specifics do not matter that much. In Puranas, the meaning is more important. Somebody is reciting verses also. Then it is, they don't recite is that it doesn't matter that much. You know, once a person came to Srila Prabhupada in India, and he was a proud, pious, Brahmin kind of person. And he asked Prabhupada, so, do your disciples know Sanskrit? So Prabhupada asked one of his disciples to chant the Govinda and Purusham prayers. They chanted. And he said, Swamiji, their pronunciation is not good. So Prabhupada said, their pronunciation may not be good, but their application is good. And they are applying it, they are living it, and that is what matters. So, here in the Puranas, it is the import that is considered important. So, Sphotavad means when we communicate, as long as the meaning is conveyed, that is what matters. Now, with respect to the names of God, which is it that applies? Is it that the literal letters have to be recited properly, or is it that the meaning has to be conveyed? Now, Jiva Goswami, he explains both ways. He says, we want to chant the mantra properly. So, but at the same time, if somebody is not able to chant the mantra properly, that is not held against them. In some languages, the sound ra is not there only. So, they may chant, halle lam, 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 halle, halle. Now, Krishna is not going to hold that as a disqualification against them. No, you cannot chant the mantras, but Krishna will be benefiting them. So from our side, we try to chant it properly. So he says that the power of the mantras, especially connected with the Supreme, they are neither in the letters, they are in the letters and they are in the meaning also. So as long as we are having the, we are chanting properly, if sometimes some pronunciation goes wrong, that's okay. But with respect to the mantras, Prabhupada also says that you don't have to understand the language of the mantra also. You just hear the mantra, you just recite the mantra, you'll get the benefit. So if the pronunciation is not important, if the meaning is also not important, it's important, but we are saying that it's not all important. Then, where is actually the mantra's potency stored? So he says the mantra's potency is stored in Krupa, in mercy. It is Krishna who manifests his omnipotent power through the mantras. So in formulas, it is just in the arrangement of letters that the meaning is stored, that the power is there. In sentences, semantic units, it is in the comprehension that the meaning is stored. But with respect to the chanting of the names of Krishna, it is that in the mercy of the Lord that the meaning is stored. That the power is stored. So just the literal recitation, if it's faulty, it doesn't matter that much. If one is trying to chant with a devotional attitude, if one understands the meaning, that is good. But if one can't understand the meaning, still, actually, the Lord sees the intention. So basically, in a precise recitation, would require some verbal skills. If somebody doesn't have that verbal dexterity, then sometimes some chanting some mantras would be very difficult. There is a Chitra Kavita Vani. Chitra Kavita Vani is just, you could say, our Rupa Goswami is having fun with words while glorifying Krishna. So there is a verse which has only two letters in it. It is describing Govardhan Leela. Dhare dhara dhar dharam dhara dhar dhura rudi dhir dhir a radha di rodham radha dhuram dharam. So now there is one verse which has only one letter in it. Ninu nano nanam nunam nanu no nana no nuni nano nana nano nunam neno nana nunanu. I don't get all of it right also, but it's something like this. So the only one sound is no in it. And pronouncing this set of verses, it can be a tongue twister. It's for those who can do it, it's great joy to do it. But some people may not be able to do it. So bhakti is not dependent on verbal ability. If somebody can't do it, they are not limited from practice. They are not deprived of practicing bhakti. Now similarly, understanding meaning, that requires to some extent some intellectual ability. Bhakti is not dependent on intellectual ability also. If somebody can't comprehend, if they still have the intention to serve Krishna, that service, Krishna will see that intention, Krishna will appreciate that intention, and Krishna will give the reward. So where is the potency of the mantra stored? It is in Krishna's mercy. That when Krishna sees us trying to serve him with a devotional attitude, he reciprocates by giving his mercy. And when he gives mercy, at that time, the mantra has dramatic transformational power. The transformational power of the mantra can be in two ways. So basically, all of us have some conditionings which push us in a particular direction. I tend to overeat, I tend to oversleep, I tend to get angry. So the conditioning pushes me in a particular direction. So now, my free will is there by which I can push back. Our past conditionings, they push us, they don't force us. We can push back. But sometimes the push may be so great that for us to push back will be very difficult. So the mantra chanting, first what it does it, or in general the process of bhakti, what it does is it increases our capacity to push back. When we chant, what happens, even if the opposition comes, even if I feel like getting angry, even if I feel like feeling negative in any way, no, I'm going to do this. So our capacity to push back increases by the practice of bhakti. So that what happens is we get connected with Krishna, and Krishna's omnipotence helps us to push back against our conditionings. So secondly, by the mercy of Krishna, the power of the conditionings themselves goes down. So they stop pushing us that much. So in our growth towards spiritual advancement, there are two stages. One is conviction and the other is purification. Conviction means I am determined to do it no matter what the obstacle is. That is, my pushing ability, my pushing power increases. Purification means the opposing power disappears. So some of us might have been eating meat before, but after we start practicing bhakti, now if you are traveling in a plane and somebody next to us is taking meat, we may not even feel tempted. Earlier we might have been craving for it. So what has happened? The opposing power itself has gone away. So Krishna's mercy can come in terms of increasing our conviction, I am going to do this. And it can come also in terms of decreasing or eliminating the opposition. And both help us to move forward steadily in bhakti. So the chanting of the mantras, sometimes you may feel that I'm chanting but my mind is still agitated. Yes, the mind may be agitated, but if you keep chanting, as we keep chanting, as we develop a taste in chanting, even if the mind gets agitated, our determination to get the mind back will increase. Yes, this chanting is so joyful, I want to do it. Even if the mind wanders, let me get it back. Mind wanders, let me get it back. And after some time, as we keep practicing bhakti, the mind's wandering itself will start decreasing, because it will also get attracted to Krishna. So now, the chanting of the mantras, so this transformation in terms of our conviction increasing or the inner opposition decreasing, it happens by the chanting. But how does it happen? It is not mechanical. It is transcendental. So today I may chant the Hare Krishna mantra and I get so much taste. I feel chanting should never end. Tomorrow I chant and I feel chanting never ends.
When is this going to get over? Sometimes you take out our beads from the bead bag.
Instead of 108 beads, has somebody put 1008 beads over it? It's not getting over. So, we may do chanting the same way in 2 days. I may recite the mantras the same way, intellectually I'm in the same frame of mind. But the experience of chanting will not be the same. Why? Because it's not just because my mind is in a different frame of mind. That is also possible. But even if my mind is the same frame of mind, even if I'm in the same frame of mind today as I was yesterday, still my experience of chanting will not be the same. Because Krishna's mercy is involved over there. And Krishna's mercy is Swarat. It's completely independent. When and why he will bestow his mercy, we don't know. Now, it is not that Krishna wants to withhold his mercy and not give it to us. It is Krishna wants us to get the realization that we are dependent on him. That we are not the ultimate doers. So, that's why, if you see in the Shikshashtakam, second verse says there is no rule in chanting. Niyamita smarane nakala. But then the next verse is Trunadapi sunijena tarorapi sahishnana amanina manadina kirtaniya sadahari. That actually you have to be humbler than a blade of grass, you have to be more tolerant than a tree. And you say this is very difficult to do. So first you say there is no rule, but then there are so many rules. I say rule, you have to become humble, so tolerant. So what is going on? Actually, the no rule is for starting chanting. Anybody can start chanting without any qualification. But if one has to come to the level of Kirtaniya Sadahari, to get the taste by which you can chant constantly, for that we have to develop this humility and tolerance. So the principle here is that when we develop this humility and tolerance, then we are understanding it is we connect with Krishna. It's like our consciousness, if say electricity is flowing through a particular object, if the object is like a conductor, then electricity will flow very easily. If the object is like an insulator, electricity will not flow at all. So as long as we have ego in us, at that time our consciousness remains like an insulator. So we chant, but the mantra doesn't enter into us. The more humility develops, the more our consciousness changes from an insulator to a conductor. And when it becomes a conductor, then the mercy flows very smoothly. And that's how Kirtaniya Sadahari starts happening. I'll conclude with one last point. That at a spiritual level, in terms of pleasing Krishna, it is only the intention that matters. The verbal recitation doesn't matter. The intellectual comprehension doesn't matter. That is in terms of pleasing Krishna. However, while doing service in this world, the material factors also matter. For the spiritual purpose of pleasing Krishna, no material factor matters. But for the purpose of manifesting a result in the material world, the material factors do matter. If we want to do kirtan where we want to attract new people, now somebody is going to sing very out of tune, they're not good singers, then their singing may please Krishna. But their singing may not attract people. So, if we want to do some service in this world, we have to find out what is appropriate in this world. When Srila Prabhupada in the last days was asked, how will the Krishna consciousness movement spread? He said, through organization and intelligence. Now, he didn't say through the purity of your heart, through the sincere chanting of the holy name. All this is required. But to get results at a material level, we have to have organization. We have to have practical planning. We have to have intelligence. Without that, the results will not come at the material level. In Ram Leela, there is the story of the squirrel. She was also carrying some small soil on her back in order to assist in building the bridge. And some of the vanaras, they said, get out of our way. Lord Ram said that you are serving according to your capacity. She is serving according to her capacity. So, I am pleased with both of you. Now, from the point of view of Lord, he was pleased with both. But if the squirrel was building the bridge, if the squirrel was carrying pieces of soil and getting it to build a bridge, how long would it take? Now, we can say Krishna can empower even a squirrel to do wonderful things. Even a squirrel can move a mountain and a squirrel can bring a mountain and he can do that. But the mood of a devotee is not that a devotee demands Krishna's miraculous intervention all the time. That is not the mood of a devotee. So, if you want a result at a material level, we have to have the material abilities, or we have to engage those who have the material abilities. The spiritual intention will always please Krishna, irrespective of whether the results come or not at the material level. But we are practicing bhakti in the material world. We are trying to share Krishna bhakti in the material world. So, we do have to consider the material appropriateness of things. And that's why for certain services, if a particular devotee is good at that service, then it is that devotee who will be engaged in that service. And others may be good, in they have great intention, and that is appreciated. But if the service is meant to reach out to people, then we have to have the appropriate blend of the material ability and the spiritual intention. That way, we will ensure that the service results not only manifest at the spiritual level in terms of pleasing Krishna, but also manifest at the material level in terms of attracting people. Now, the danger over here is that somebody who just has the material ability but does not have the spiritual intention, they may become very impressive. They may attract a lot of people. Some people may just be able to recite the Bhagavatam brilliantly, do Bhagavat Katha. But if they don't have devotion, then they will just be doing the externals and they'll get the external result. But the internal transformation may not be happening. That's why we cannot go only on the material results. We cannot say that just because somebody is getting a lot of material results, that means they must be great. But we cannot go unmindful of the material side of the service also. When Arjuna fought the Kurukshetra war, after hearing the Bhagavad Gita, did Arjuna win the Kurukshetra war because of the knowledge of the Bhagavad Gita or because of the knowledge of archery that he had learned throughout his life? What do you think? Was it because of the knowledge of Bhagavad Gita or the knowledge of archery? It's both. And we could say that even if he did not know archery, Krishna could have empowered anybody else and they could have fought. That's fine. But Arjuna practiced archery throughout his life, became excellent in archery, and that archery skill was used. So the Bhagavad Gita's knowledge gave the spiritual direction. The material execution was done by his skill. And the combination of the spiritual direction and the material execution, that produced the result of victory. So similarly, for us, if we want to do a particular service, we want to cultivate the spiritual intention, but to get the result in the material world, we also have to develop the necessary material competence. And that way, we will be able to get the results that Srila Prabhupada wants in terms of attracting many, many people to Krishna's lotus feet. So I'll summarize. I spoke today about how the spiritual sound vibration relates with manifests at the material level. How do the chanting of the mantras with our material senses, how does it exactly lead to transformation? So where is the potency of the mantras? One school says Varnava, the meaning is in the letters itself. It's like a formula. And if you don't understand it, you get the letters right, you get the result. So Vedic mantras are like that. So if you get a small, some pronunciation wrong, it's like in a software code, the computer which is reading the software and executing it, the computer does not look at your intention or your meaning. It just looks at the code. The code is saying something not instead of yes, then the computer will do, machine will do it exactly wrong. So the Varnavad school of thought is that the higher forces in nature, they are mechanical. And if we invoke them wrong, the opposite result will come. So Sphotavad holds that the meaning of mantras is stored in the power of mantras is stored in the meaning. It is only when we understand it. So Vedas were more like Varnavad. The letter precise recitation is important. In the Puranas, it is the understanding that is important. Even if the pronunciation is not that great, it is the application, comprehension and application that matters. And if we come to the chanting of the mantras related with Krishna, the power is stored, there is precise, we try to recite the mantra well, we try to understand its meaning also, but the essential thing is the intention. The power is in Krishna's mercy. And because Krishna's mercy is independent, so that's why 2 days we may chant in the same way, but the result, the experience may not be the same. So Krishna doesn't withhold his mercy, but Krishna gives his mercy based on how our consciousness is. As long as we think we are the doers and we have the ego, then that is makes our consciousness like a resistor or an insulator, which does not allow the current of mercy to flow. But when we develop humility, then our consciousness becomes like a conductor and Krishna's mercy flows through it. And for getting results in this world, we need to consider not only the spiritual intention but also the material ability. Only then will the result come out. It says Arjuna won the war by getting spiritual direction from the Gita and by getting the skill for material execution from his archery practice. So thank you very much. Hare Krishna. So do we have a minute or two for question? Okay, fine. We'll stop. Okay. Thank you very much. Grantharaj Srimad Bhagavatam ki
Jai.
Srila Prabhupada ki
Jai.
Gaura Bhaktavinda ki
Jai.
Gaura Premanandaji
Prabhu ki Jai.